Westchester Township History Museum, and today we are going to be learning about the life of Alice Gray, who you might know better as Diana of the Dunes. Alice Gray's life has a lot of myths surrounding it, so today we're going to talk about what her life here in the dunes was actually like. We're also going to be hiking the National Park's new trail, the Diana of the Dunes Dare. So let's get started. Alice was born in Chicago in 1881, and both of her parents had passed away by the time she was 17. This meant she had to become very independent very quickly. She was also incredibly intelligent. She graduated from the University of Chicago with a degree in mathematics and went on to take graduate courses at both the University of Göttingen in Germany and back at the University of Chicago. For a woman as intelligent and independent as Alice, she didn't have the opportunity she wanted living in Chicago in the early 1900s. There were a lot of expectations for women that didn't meet her goals and what she wanted to do. So she decided to come out here and live in the Indiana Dunes, free from those expectations that she felt were holding her back. Alice made the decision to move out to the dunes in October of 1915. This really wasn't the ideal time to decide to move and live outside. In the summers, the dunes are typically hot and sunny, but after September, the weather can get really cold. In October, it's typically a high of 63 degrees and a low of 43 degrees. And today, on this day in March that we're recording, it's actually only 31 degrees outside, so pretty chilly. So that weather sounds great for hiking, but it can be pretty tough if you're living outside. When Alice first moved out to the dunes, those first few nights she slept under the stars. All she had brought with her on the train ride were a blanket, a cup, a knife, and a gun. Alice quickly wanted to find a more permanent home, and she came across a shack that had been abandoned by a man named George Blagg, who was a hermit who had lived in the dunes. She quickly moved in and made it her home, calling it Driftwood. When Alice arrived in the dunes, she found a refuge from her life in the city. Back in the early 1900s, there were far fewer people living in and visiting the dunes, so she remained relatively undetected by anyone other than the few families she visited who lived nearby. She would travel by foot into town to get food and supplies, and spent a lot of time at the Miller Library reading books. She spent most of her free time hiking the dunes and recording the things she saw, keeping manuscripts of her time here. While she did love living here, Alice had to learn how to survive in the wilderness. She had to learn how to stay warm and safe, and there were inevitably some missteps. One of these missteps was recounted in her diary she kept of her time here. I remembered it had rained a little the night before, and my blankets were a little damp. So I built a fire in the iron box I'd found ready at hand, which makes cooking so unexpectedly convenient, and spread out my possessions on the ground around it. Feeling very happy and domestic and much pleased with myself and the world, my world, large and small, when, the fire dying down and my towels being not quite dry, I moved the iron firebox with the idea that the sand under it would be the best means of finishing the drying, and deliberately put my hand, my right hand, caressingly on the sand to see if it was warm enough to do the towel much good, I suppose. My God, how it hurt! The shame of having done such a fool thing was hardly second to the pain of the burn. Alice befriended a few of the local families that lived near her driftwood shack, and they would help her out by selling her supplies like bread and eggs and having over for coffee and meals. She would also take the children of these families on hikes and teach them about the nature in the dunes. However, visiting these families did remind Alice of how different her lifestyle was from most people's. She recounted one of these visits with the Larson family in an excerpt from her diary. Friday, I walked to Oak Hill, and while waiting for Mrs. Larson to come home with my groceries, I had the first good look at myself in some time. To tell the truth, I was shocked. My eyes seemed to have a rather wild, strained look, as if the life I was leading was very wearing on me. I said to myself that I would be afraid if I met myself alone at the crossroad in the moonlight. However, I was not so bad with my hat and coat on. Even with her driftwood shack, staying warm in the winter would be tough. The average wind speed this time of year is 10 miles per hour, but it can get even faster the closer you get to the lake. When it got too cold, Alice would stay in a place called the Sassafras Lodge, which was owned by William and Flora Richardson. Well, the Richardson were members of a group called the Prairie Club. The Prairie Club was a group that was trying to create a sand dunes national park. They met Alice on one of their many hikes through the area. Alice actually spoke in support of creating this national park at one of their meetings at Fullerton Hall in Chicago. Unfortunately, the start of World War I put any plans for a national park on hold. So the Indiana Dune Country, like Chicago herself, is the child of Lake Michigan and the Northwest Wind. Besides its nearness to Chicago and its beauty, its spiritual power, There is between the dune country and city a more than sentimental tie. It is a family tie. See the dunes destroyed would be for Chicago the sacrilegious sin which is not forgiven. One thing Alice did that caught a lot of people's attention was bathe in the lake, but she did this out of necessity. She didn't have plumbing in her driftwood shack. Also, she didn't do this all times of year. Right now in the winter, that water's about 30 degrees Fahrenheit, which is way too cold for a person to get in. So she probably wasn't taking many baths in the middle of winter. After she became known as Diana of the Dunes, there was one person Alice met that she welcomed into her life, and that was Paul Wilson. Paul Wilson was a local drifter who had a reputation as a petty thief, but he and Alice got along really well. He soon moved into her driftwood shack, but shortly after he moved in, he was accused of robbing some of the local beach houses in the area. He was put in jail for a short time, and after he got out, he and Alice decided to move to try to reclaim some of their privacy. The area that Alice and Paul ended up moving to is now known as Ogden Dunes. Here, they built a new shack they named Wren's Nest. The property they lived on was eventually purchased by a man named Samuel Reck, but he let them continue living there, and even hired Paul to do things like build furniture and take people out on boat rides. Alice and Paul managed to keep a low profile for about 2 years, but unfortunately, trouble followed them to their new home. A body was found near their old shack, driftwood. Despite having no other connection to the case, local authorities began to look into them as suspects. Once newspaper reporters heard about this, they also began to run more stories about Alice and Paul. And even a local deputy named Eugene Frank would feed these reporters gossip and even lead them to Alice and Paul's shack to talk to them. Alice and Paul got extremely frustrated by this and decided to confront Frank. It resulted in a fight, and both Alice and Paul were injured. Alice was hospitalized, and Paul was again thrown in jail. While they were gone from Wren's Nest, it was ransacked, and many of Alice's manuscripts were stolen, causing us to lose a huge amount of information about her life. When Alice and Paul returned to Wren's Nest, they decided they again wanted to try to reclaim some of their privacy, so they made a plan to move to Texas. They even built a boat. But after being gone for 6 months, they returned to the dunes and moved back into their shack. On February 8th, Alice fell ill, and she refused any kind of medical care. Despite this, Paul managed to convince Samuel Reck to bring a doctor to their shack, but by then it was too late. Alice passed away on February 9th, 1925. Today, Alice's legend lives on in the dunes that she called home. If you want to experience walking in Alice's footsteps and see firsthand why this place meant so much to her, you can come hike the Diana of the Dunes Trail here at West Beach, part of the Indiana Dunes National Park. Thank you so much for joining us.